First innovation I would like to suggest is that hereafter, instead of losing precious time in garlands and presentations, we should do it as deemed to have been given and deemed to have been received. You know, very often when we have annual general meetings of companies, they say the auditor's report is deemed to have been read by the shareholders. It's normally a very long report because it's a token of regard, and yes, we accept it very kindly. Second, as a small point of information, he did mention that I had done my master's from the University of California, Berkeley in public administration, but he omitted mentioning that I had also done an MSc in physics at the Patna University. Now, maybe it is because he thought reference to University of California, Berkeley, where I got a fellowship, is somehow more impressive than Patna University. But let me tell you, at the time when I did finish that MSc program in 1960, it was, along with Calcutta University and others, regarded very well as a center of learning. And we had some very, very fine teachers and professors. And I have great pleasure in always acknowledging the fact that people like Mr. Shahabuddin, who later on joined the Janata Party after a distinguished diplomatic career, was my prefect in Faraday House. And eventually, in the final class, I was the senior prefect of Cavendish House. Now, so far as this question of all transforming Delhi into a knowledge society, I want to share with everyone in this room my firm belief. Nobody can be a high caliber professional in the true sense until he firstly fulfills the need and requirement of being totally honest and enjoying highest personal integrity. Because if you are not that, I think that the first filter, you just cannot carry out that high standard of professionalism. I've said it on many occasions, what India now needs is hardcore ethical professionals who know their domain very well, but they are also ethically, absolutely, unimpeachably honest and correct. No compromises. We were saying to the other day, we were discussing about how to have better quality assurance in all the works undertaken in the National Capital Territory of Delhi. And I've said it also to the Delhi Development Authority, we are going for massive housing schemes. We have said the third party quality assurance will be by this Shriram Center for Industrial and Scientific Research. And one of the reasons is that there are 400 scientists who are part of that group who carry out quality testing. I think for the last 50 years or more, they have enjoyed a reputation that they will not make any compromises in terms of giving a correct test and analysis result. There is absolutely no dilution. And many other testing laboratories, you say, isko aise badal do, ye kar do. No, they are absolutely hardcore. Now, I think also if we have engineers, doctors, accountants, civil servants, police officers, and every other profession, who are ethically sound and also know their domain well, they will actually be great value adders to the nation in every respect, whether it's in the field of economy, infrastructure, social development, because they will add real value. They will not be value strippers. There are some people who add value, there are some people who strip value. People who are actually getting into absentee roles, you know, of staff in different departments, and are first to collect their salary on the first of the month, but when it comes to service delivery to the people and to the citizens of our great country, they are also the first one to basically play truant, and the nation can't afford it. So I think that's one thing I wish to emphasize, and I do hope that everyone will make it absolutely fundamental condition going forward as professionals, that they'll be totally committed to 100% honesty and integrity. Now, the second thing I want to say is, you know, India has been endowed, and the Indians particularly, with probably the best intellectual resources that nature has endowed to any group of people in the world. I think we should be extremely proud of it. It has been proven by our scientists, our technologists, our IT specialists, and the world now acknowledges that Indian brain, there is something very unique. That being the case, until very recently, we have been always following scientific leads, you know, which start in other countries, whether it is in United States or England or Japan or Germany. I think it's high time we actually initiate those changes ourselves. Now, the reason I say this is because in my view, a lot of the work which has been done overseas, and particularly in the Western countries and all, is not really a holistic view of things. It is a partial view of things. You take the field of pharmacology or pharmaceuticals, practically all the medications which have been devised, they have a symptomatic effect. They'll take you through a period of severe, you know, physical ailment or crisis, but they don't really heal you from within. They give you symptomatic treatment. Most of the time, the disease symptom is driven in, and after some time, you suddenly begin to see you had pain medicine for arthritis for 10 years, suddenly you have kidney failure at the end of this. Now, in many areas, I have found, you know, whether it was even the Green Revolution, yes, you keep on pumping in artificial scientific, this nitrogenous fertilizers, phosphates and all, use pesticides for pest control. But the result of that 30 years of Green Revolution, I come from Punjab, is that the soil fertility has taken a huge fall. And for every, you know, even to maintain current yields, you have to keep on increasing your input costs. At the end of it, it has become less and less remunerative. And you find the production has been going down and so on. People are now going back to organic farming. And again, plowing back, you know, maybe these leguminous varieties of some short crops into the soil to restore natural soil fertility and the nitrogenous and other micronutrient components. So in many fields, you know, if you take at today's solutions, what people are going for, I think they suffer from the fact that they are not holistic solutions. And I think India can make a huge contribution because it is able to see the holistic picture, to be able to look at all those dimensions and then propose lines of innovation which will truly respect that whole issue of ecological balance and harmony with nature and so on. We have always talked in our Shanti part, we always say Shanti Prithvi, Shanti Rapa, Shanti Roshadeya and this and that. Everything, Shant, Shant, Shant. Here nothing is at peace. The water quality has deteriorated so badly. Parts of Punjab, I know, Haryana. I met the Chief Minister yesterday, Haryana. He was saying cancer is spreading in those areas due to massive amount of water being, you know, seriously polluted. All the runoffs from fertilizers and pesticides. Now, this kind of a problem, we all said hosannas to lovely things, but where was the holistic view? What is it doing to the ground table and how is the water quality changing? We talked about giving free power to farmers, very good political gimmick, but we found over-exploitation of groundwater, and the land of the five rivers are now at least three, Ravi, Bias and Satluj in Punjab. Water tables have fallen very seriously, and suddenly we have no water to give to Haryana or urban areas of Delhi and Gurgaon. Just very poorly, very poor efficiency in terms of water use. So I think we need to look at some of these other dimensions. Are we really going in the right direction? Now, I want to tell you about a book written by a fellow called Dr. Musharraf Ali. He's a doctor from Bangladesh. And he has written a book about holistic healing. He is a personal kind of health advisor to some of the biggest celebrities in the UK, including Prince Charles. And what he did his allopathic medicine from Moscow University, but was told at some point that you must not ignore the holistic healing tradition of our native countries in South Asia. And he picked up those threads of Yunani, Ayurveda, this whatever is homeopathy, naturopathy, and just written a beautiful book, Holistic Healing. He has taken that view because Ayurveda and this one heals you from within. It boosts your immunity system and makes you better able to fight illness rather than simply being dosed with medicine and ultimately suppressing your symptoms down, and ultimately it will hit some other fundamental function in the body. So I would suggest that when Indian scientists talk about innovation, they must keep the holistic dimension in view. I think this can be India's great contribution to true global innovation. The world is looking up to India now for leadership in the field of innovation, and I think it's high time we begin to use our God-given intellectual resources to discharge that responsibility to global humankind. We certainly have the ability to do so, and I do hope and pray that the efforts being made by our technological and scientific community will lead us in that direction. Thank you.